Hi everyone, my name is Teodor Mitev, and in this lecture I want to talk about the OODA loop. The OODA loop is a theory, and started as a theory of maneuver warfare, developed by US Air Force Colonel and fighter pilot John Boyd. He started developing this theory, this model of maneuver warfare following the Korean War and his experiences in the Korean War. And he was thinking of it as a process involving a high-speed decision-making and continuous feedback loops. And he, over the years following the Korean War, he distilled this process into four key stages, which he described as observe, orient, decide, and act, hence OODA, to be performed continuously in a feedback loop, hence loop. And his argument was that when deployed successfully, this model of thinking and acting in the world, so thinking about the world, about reality, and acting in reality in a continuous feedback loop, when deployed successfully, this approach leads to a situation where in his case he was giving examples about air warfare. So combatants would go through an OODA loop faster, make faster decisions, and take faster actions, better informed actions, and combatants who go through this loop faster would be much more likely to gain an advantage over their opponents. But the OODA loop is far more than just that. The OODA loop, and both John Boyd and his collaborators in the development of this concept, such as Franklin Spinney, whom we'll encounter in a second, they realized pretty quickly that this model is far more than simply a model of maneuver warfare. It's a model of operating in conditions of adversity in a complex, continuously changing environment. So for our purposes, what's really interesting in the OODA loop as a concept and as a model of thinking and acting, thinking about and acting in a complex world, is that first, it's a continuous cycle, right? This is not a one-off thing that one should do. It's a continuous a process that we deploy as we perform ourselves in existence, if you will. It involves a feedback and response loops, which are both a front-facing feedback, informing future actions, and backward-facing feedback, as it were, in which actions inform decisions. It involves a dynamic, continuous analysis and synthesis of reality and of our actions in reality. So, analysis here stands for a top-down approach involving deploying an existing model and trying to match it to the stimuli that reach our senses, and I'll talk about this more in a second. Well, synthesis involves the opposite, so it's a bottom-up process of matching or identifying stimuli reaching our senses and trying to form some sort of inductive patterns which would inform action in reality. So the OODA loop involves both analysis and synthesis working together. And crucially, this is a dynamic process of action and evaluation. Again, this is not a one-off thing, and it's not a sequential cycle which must be performed, as it were, step by step. And in the rest of this lecture, we'll analyze each of these steps and see how they operate, and try and trace the feedback loops involved, and why are they so interesting, why are they so important. Okay, but before we begin, it's really important that we establish a clear perspective of the domain, of the environment in which the OODA loop becomes a necessary concept to encounter, a necessary model. And the way John Boyd framed it in his Destruction and Creation slides is that in a real world of limited resources and skills, individuals and groups form, dissolve and reform their cooperative or competitive postures in a continuous struggle to remove or overcome physical and social environmental obstacles. The key thing here is first that this is a continuous struggle, and this is a struggle that both individuals and organizations and complex, if you will, organisms undergo continuously, right? It's not a one-off thing. And hence the model that we are going to be discussing, the OODA loop model, applies both to individuals and to complex organizations. And it involves the encounter with reality. And reality here is by definition an unknown, which is chaotic because no model can accurately predict it continuously, right? That's first. And second, reality always, because of its status as an unknown, chaotic, complex space, which cannot be simplified to a predictable model, continuously throws obstacles, continuously throws unpredictable situations, which we need to somehow overcome, both as individuals and organizations, right? Hence, the necessity of having a model which allows us to act in this kind of environment dynamically, if you will. And to discern what is going on in this kind of environment, we must interact in a variety of ways in order to test the environment itself, right? We must interact in a variety of ways with our environment. So this is a really interesting statement because it is both on the surface very obvious. Clearly, we must interact in a variety of ways with our environment in order to discern what's going on. But simultaneously, it's a really deep observation because you cannot know that what John Boyd is saying is that you cannot know truly anything about your environment until you have tried acting in it in a variety of ways, right? You might have one or several or multiplicity of different models of that environment, trying to predict to a certain extent what it actually is. But until you act in a variety of ways, not in one way, but a variety of ways in that environment, you truly do not know what is going on, right? So this is actually a really deep observation about the necessity for action, which in turn provides important feedback, allowing us to observe and orient ourselves in reality. And we'll talk more about this down the track in a second. And I mentioned that this is just now that this comes from John Boyd's slide. So one of the interesting things about John Boyd as a thinker was that he really hated with a passion dogma. He specifically used that word. So he hated dogma, and he hated established procedure because he believed that established procedures lead to dogma, which in turn is nothing more, nothing less, but a fixed model of reality, right? And fixed models have that unfortunate side effect of not being able to fit with reality and leading to completely erroneous actions, erroneous decisions, and fundamentally and inevitably to collapse. Because reality acts as an entropic force on the outside of whatever system is acting in it. So again, we must interact in a variety of ways with our environment. And continuing on that thought, and again from John Boyd, we must be able to examine the world in which we operate from a number of perspectives so that we can generate mental images or impressions that correspond to that world. And that's building on what we just discussed just now. But the key element here is that we act not based on the world. We act based on the mental images or impressions that we form about the world, right? So the mental images or impressions form a frame through which we interpret reality, make decisions and or observations about reality, and which in turn informs our decisions and actions in reality, right? So this should be suggesting to you already the tremendous importance of the process of having a continuous feedback loop with reality in order to refine the mental images or impressions that we've developed, and in order to make them correspond to the world as much as possible. Needless to say, and this should be obvious to you if you have been paying attention so far, because the world is complex and chaotic by definition, so this is an axiom, right? So this is a non-negotiable axiomatic statement. The world is complex and chaotic, unpredictable. Therefore, the mental images or impressions that we form that and we try to focus them in such a way so that they can correspond to that world, these images, this frame is never perfect. And the longer this frame persists and the longer we use this frame, the less perfect it is, the less it corresponds to that world, because that world is changing continuously, right? So that frame itself needs continuous dynamic updating as well. So here is how it all looks so far. So this is, we operate in a complex environment, and this is how Boyd frames the necessity of having this kind of a model, which basically this is all leading up to an understanding of why we need something like the OODA loop model. Against such a background of a chaotic and complex environment, actions and decisions become critically important. And we've already understood why, right? Actions must be taken over and over again and in many different ways. Why? Because this is the only way in which we can test our model of reality, right? And this model of reality is the only thing we have, actually. This is how we orient ourselves in reality. It's not by observing reality directly. Right? Because reality is so complex and chaotic that this process, this notion of observing it directly and making decisions and actions entirely depending on that imaginary direct observation, this is an impossibility. Right? So what happens instead is that we form a mental picture model, a frame. And this frame, in order for it to have any chance whatsoever to correspond to some extent, right? It never can correspond perfectly with reality. Actions must be taken over and over again, and in many different ways, in order to test different approaches. Moreover, decisions must be rendered to monitor and determine the precise nature of the actions needed. That will be compatible with the goal, right? So the decision-making process here acts as a refining element to the actions needed. And we'll talk more about this down the track in this lecture. To make these timely decisions implies that we must be able to form mental concepts of observed reality as we perceive it, and be able to change these concepts as reality itself appears to change. And we already touched on that, right? So these mental concepts of observed reality are fundamental, and we need to be able to change them and update them dynamically, because reality continuously changes both on its own and as a result of our actions, right? So you have a number of feedback loops involved here. Once again, showing how dynamic this process is and what a complex environment we are actually dealing with. Okay, so let's break it down and jump now, following this, into trying to explore the different stages here involved. So first, we have continuous actions in a complex and changing reality. These actions have to take place if we want to have a more or less up-to-date, more or less corresponding model of reality in our minds. We have decisions being involved, which I needed to ensure that the model we have of reality is in sync with that changing reality, right? Because these decisions inform the actions. We have a process of orientation, which is based on these mental concepts of reality. So this is that central process where we are literally figuring out what is what and why and how, based on that frame of reality which we have in our minds. And finally, or rather firstly, depending on which way you're looking at this from, you have the necessity of observations of actions and results in a changing reality. So these are the four stages we're talking about. And the key thing about the OODA loop from the perspective of perception and action in a complex environment, and this is actually the perspective that I at least am interested in when it comes to this concept, and this is the perspective for informing this lecture, is that when you understand the concept of the OODA loop, and when you deploy this model and try and consciously perform this model in reality, it's really helpful, because when something like Franklin Spinney points out, Franklin Spinney is a collaborator of John Boyd and systematizer of his work, when things go out of whack, we can see something new and strange. And that is when we learn something, right? When the environment changes, when our plans, our model of reality is misaligned with that reality, and crucially, when we discover this misalignment between our model of reality and reality itself, and we discover it only based on actions, right, which have backfired, something has failed, hence when things go out of whack, that is when we see new and strange things, right? Because there is a gap, there is a misalignment. And it is this gap, this misalignment between our model of reality and reality itself, the failure of our actions, if you will, this is what actually leads to learning when the model is deployed. This is what leads to iteration. This is what leads to innovation. This is what leads to novelty, if you will. So what we are trying to grapple with here, the parameters of the OODA loop model that we've described so far, are that we have a organic model because it's organic, because it is informed by the organic stages of the way the mind processes reality and then reacts to reality. And so these are the organic stages of how the mind operates and adapts in a chaotic and complex environment. And we're trying to analyze these stages and observe them consciously and hone them, if you will. So we have observe, orient, decide, and act. Let's start with the first stage, with observation. So the first thing is that this is a continuous process, right? It never stops. If you stop observing, you cut out a fundamental feedback loop with reality, and at that moment, the organization that has stopped observing, or the individual that has stopped observing, has stopped receiving stimuli from the external reality, right? It has cut itself off. So this automatically leads to collapse, right? Because of that total misalignment which is immediately generated. So this is observation is a continuous process. It is a direct contact with that complex and changing reality we've been describing. And it involves a continuous gathering of data, gathering of information, noticing emergent patterns or changing patterns, and matching them to existing schema. And what is existing schema? This is that frame, that model of reality we have already operating in our minds, right? So schema can be extremely complex. For every individual, schema involve a number of very detailed patterns that have been inserted in our minds through interactions with the external environment since birth. schema can be changed, right? And they can be altered by the addition of a new associative change, by the addition of new patterns matching different phenomena. So the observation stage involves a continuous process. It's a direct contact with reality, and it's all about gathering information, gathering patterns. And the key thing is that there is no such thing as objective observation, right? So this should be obvious. The invariably, and this is independent of whether the entity observing reality is an individual or a complex organization. So invariably, all observations of that external world, of that external reality, are filtered through the cognitive apparatus of the observer. If that's an organization doing the observation, then we have a cognitive apparatus of the observation, involving existing models of reality, existing schema, existing patterns that the organization has internalized as ways to act in the world, right? So the cognitive apparatus of the observer is key here, because it is that cognitive apparatus, that frame, that filters the external world, that allows things to be seen or not to be seen, right? That obfuscates elements of reality or makes them outright invisible. So the observed stage in this description of the OODA loop process is the first stage, although it's really important not to think of the OODA loop process as a teleological process leading from point A to point B and C to point D, and then starting again, right? So often these stages work simultaneously at the same time. So we'll talk more about this down the track. The key thing about the observed stage is that it is a direct interaction with reality. Reality feeds information directly to the sensory apparatus of the observer, whether that be an individual or an organization. But simultaneously, the observed stage is fed back information from the orientation stage, because the orientation stage is the stage, we'll talk more about this in a second, is the stage where things are figured out based on existing schema, based on the frame, that the model of reality that the observer already has, right? So there is an immediate feedback loop there when it comes to the observer stage. But it's also fed information, so it's not feed forward, but feed backward loop here from the decide and act stages, because important elements being of the model of reality are being already developed in the decision stage. So because the decision stage sets up a hypothesis for action in reality, and then the action stage itself triggers some change in reality, which automatically is fed back in the observation. So the observation stage is really important because it gathers information and feeds that information to the orientation stage, where the model of reality gets to process it. And as I already mentioned, observations of reality are informed by existing schema, by the existing frame of reference in the mind of the observer or in the memory of the observing entity. And therefore, there is always a mismatch. And this is a really important point to understand, right? Observations are never perfect by definition. Axiomatically, they're always wrong, because they always miss huge amounts of information about reality. This is invariable. And there is always a mismatch between the complex and chaotic reality being observed and the mental model generated by observation. Right? So the mental model which the observation produces is invariably faulty. The whole goal here is to make it as close to corresponding to reality as possible. And this faultiness, again, is caused by the fact that observations cannot be separated from the various interior mental processes of each observer. right? And these interior mental processes and the frames which generate them invariably differ from the complex nature of the observed reality. This leads us to the next stage, the orient stage. And the orient stage is probably the most important stage in the OODA loop process in the model developed by John Boyd. Let's examine it. So the orient stage is a continuous process, right? Unlike the observed stage, however, it has no direct contact with reality, right? The orient stage is all about the interaction between the stimuli that have arrived in the mind from the observation stage and the various existing mental models of reality already in the mind. And the orient stage is all about the analysis and synthesis. So this is a simultaneous process of deploying an existing model, which is analytical, right? It's top-down, it's deductive thinking, and looking at those raw inputs and trying to generate a model from them in opposition to the existing model, so which is a synthesis, it's a synthetic process, which is inductive thinking. And so this is an analysis and synthesis of observed information and patterns. And as Franklin Spinner frames it, the orientation shape stage is crucial because it shapes how we see. There is a feedback, feedbackward loop from orientation to observation, and shapes how we see reality, as well as what we see because of that model which is deployed. And the how we see evolves over time based on new input, right? Based on a feedback loop. So we have the how and the what. And that's a key stage because on the one hand, it links two feedback loop stages, right? Observation and decision action. And on the other hand, it generates the testable decisions in the first place, right? So in order for us to be able to have a hypothesis about what to do, this is the decision stage, right? Having a hypothesis of some sort about what to do based on the model that we have in our minds, how to act in reality, and what to expect as a result, right? So this is what the decision stage is. But in order to have that, we need to have a model of reality. So this is what the orientation stage is. And a key element here, and one of the weaknesses, if you will, of the orientation stage, one of the exploits, if you will, of the orientation stage, is that it's entirely dependent on feedback coming from observation, as well as other phenomena which our sensory apparatus collects, other information streams which are directly hitting our mental model of reality, right? Our frame. So it's dependent on feedback and other phenomena sensed in the observation stage. Therefore, during the observation stage, we collect the wrong information, the wrong inputs, or faulty information, faulty inputs, this automatically leads to us having the wrong mental model being created, because the orientation stage is entirely dependent on that feedback and on that information. So what we have here is again a key stage in the OODA loop, because on the one hand it is fed from data and input from the observation window, but it also feeds back automatically a model of seeing the world, while at the same time directly feeds into how we act, because how we act is entirely a function of the model of reality we have in our minds, right? Hence this double feedback loop, feed forward and feed backwards when it comes to the orientation stage. And the interplay of observations and orientation generates this cycle. It's a continuous, never-ending cycle of mismatches and destruction and creation. And why mismatches, destruction and creation? Quite simply, because there is a continuous mismatch between the model we have of reality and reality itself, and the analytical and synthetic process that the orientation stage is continuously undergoing, right? So we are analyzing reality based on our existing model and synthesizing the new input into a model, which leads to the change of the existing model, right? This is a continuous process of destruction and creation, right? That is happening in our minds non-stop, right? Continuously. It's a never-ending cycle. And John Boyd considered the orientation stage the key, most important strategic stage when it comes to the OODA loop. And he spent inordinate amount of time researching this stage and talking about it in his presentations. He called it the Schwerpunkt. And Schwerpunkt is a term coming from German military theory, and it stands for a place in a battle line which is crucial from the perspective of the internal coherence of that battle line. So a Schwerpunkt, attacking a Schwerpunkt successfully would involve the collapse of the entire battle line. And from the perspective of Boyd's analysis, the orientation stage is right exactly such a Schwerpunkt, because any vulnerability in the way we orient ourselves in reality, in the way we build a mental model of reality, automatically leads to the collapse of our decisions and actions in reality. So orientation is a Schwerpunkt. It shapes the way we interact with the environment. Hence, orientation shapes the way we observe, the way we decide, and the way we act. Right? And we can see this represented here with this forward and backward feedback loops stemming from the orientation stage. It shapes, crucially, it shapes the present form of the OODA loop, while the present OODA loops automatically feed back into our mental model of reality, informing the future orientation stages, right? So it's a continuous self-reinforcing mechanism. And this brings us to the follow-up stage, which is decision, the stage in which we deploy a hypothesis about reality developed based on our orientation in reality. So this is a non-continuous process, because often we skip it. Often organizations skip it. Often organizations act immediately without having a detailed or even vague hypothesis about the results from the actions, right? Often action is based automatically on orientation, without any model of how this action might actually operate in reality and what the results might be, which is fine. This is, let's call this implicit actions. But often, quite to the contrary, we are trying to think and have a clear model of how our actions will be deployed in reality and what the result will be. We might have one or several hypotheses to that extent. Hence, it's a non-continuous process. Crucially, it has also no direct contact with reality, right? It's a mental process as well. And it involves this hypothesizing about the results of our actions and the outcome that they might be generating. The decision stage is entirely dependent on the observation and orientation loop, and it feeds back into actions and observations, because the deployment of our hypothesis about reality, right, might be successful and or unsuccessful. And whatever the outcome of that hypothesis, that outcome feeds automatically into the observation and back into the orientation stage, right? Hence why you will notice that there is a feed forward element from decision to action, but also feedback and element from decision to observation and then to orientation again. And then finally, we have the action stage, which on our graph representing the model, the OODA loop model, is the final element. But as I already mentioned, the OODA loop actions often happen simultaneously, and it's a continuous process. So it's probably wrong to describe it as a final stage. It's also a continuous process, right? We continuously act in our environment. Keep in mind that inaction, right, passivity is also a form of action. It involves, as like the observation stage, it involves a direct contact with reality, right? Hence, it's a strategic stage as well, because this is the stage that allows us to compare our models of reality with reality itself. This is where literally we interface with reality. And it's strategic also because we interface with reality and we change it through our actions. And procedurally, right, it involves performing the actions which are implied during orientation, when we have a model of reality which is informed by the observations and all hypothesized in the process of decision making. Right, so you will notice that there are two stages in the entire process, the entire OODA loop process, which interface with reality. That's the observation stage and the action stage, right? And in the action stage, we are on the receiving end of feedback from reality, the reality itself in all its chaotic complexity, but also reality itself in reaction to our actions, but also it's on the receiving end also for feed forward loop from the decision stage or the orientation stage, while there is a feedback loop from action to observation, because we naturally observe continuously as our actions percolate through reality. So here we have it. We have the four stages, and observation, orientation, and action are continuous processes, as I already mentioned, while the decision stage is appearing occasionally in consequence of these three stages. Observe, orient, decide, act. The OODA loop. Now, this is how John Boyce himself displayed the OODA loop and how he described it. You would notice that he dedicated the most attention to the orientation stage. As I already mentioned, the orientation stage is crucial because this is where a model of reality actually is fed information about the world and about our actions in the world, and in turn directly informs future actions or future decisions in a feed-forward process, right? So notice how there is a line coming out from the orientation stage leading to the action stage in an implicit guidance and control vector, which involves a non-verbal, implicit, non-planned action, right? As opposed to the decision process, which is a formal process of making a decision about future actions and in having some sort of idea about the desired outcome. And you notice also that in the orientation stage, we have all sorts of pre-existing elements already residing in the mind, already residing in perception, that inform how we operate in reality. So these are cultural traditions and genetic heritage, new information coming in continuously, previous experience interacting with new information and with the other elements, as well as analysis and synthesis. So this is a continuous cycle of feedback and response based on that process of analysis, synthesis, and evaluation of what has happened. And again, taking a step back, the OODA loop is a fascinating concept, and it's a really important model to understand and learn how to deploy a model of reality, because it involves learning how to make decisions in complex environments and lead to decisive action at a systemic level. Why systemic? Because once the model is deployed consciously, one could generate systemic outcomes based on observing, orienting, deciding, and acting in a certain way. And these systemic outcomes were suggested by Boyd in his concept of fast transients. And it's a fascinating concept, which he first deployed to air warfare and and the maneuvers of fighter pilots, and then extended to literally acting in complex reality. So fast transients. The faster a competitor gathers data from the field observation and analyzes it into meaningful information orientation, the faster their decision making, decides Sage, which in turn gives them the opportunity to act beyond an opponent's cognitive envelope. And this is how John Boyd described it, right? There is everyone has a cognitive envelope, and this cognitive envelope is defined by their OODA loop. And it involves a model of reality which everyone has, and a capacity to observe and a capacity to decide and to act with a certain speed at a certain level of consistency. And that forms the cognitive envelope. And from John Boyd's perspective, this concept of fast transient suggests that in any sort of competition, in order to win and defeat a competitor, overcome an obstacle, we should operate at a faster tempo rhythm than our adversaries. Or better yet, get inside the adversary's OODA loop or OODA time cycle. So what did he mean by getting inside? This is a really fascinating side problem that probably is worth a separate lecture or two. But for our brief purposes, getting inside an opponent's cognitive envelope, their time cycle, involves being able to process reality faster based on a more adequate model of reality. Being able to take actions faster than the opponent, which in turn creates a reality which the opponent has to process with their slower apparatus, with their slower cognitive envelope, right? So if one were to generate, by extension of John Boyd's thinking, if one were to generate having a fast transient OODA loop, if one were to generate a number of false or misleading actions, thereby affecting reality, one would automatically lead the enemy or the opponent or the competitor or whatever, because this can be very easily applied to corporations, for example, towards inappropriate action or action leading to catastrophic consequences, leading to massive misalignment between their model of reality and reality itself. And this is how he explains it. Such activity, right, deploying successfully a fast transient OODA loop, will make us appear ambiguous, unpredictable, because of the speed of action and operation that is faster than an opponent. So it will make us appear ambiguous, unpredictable, thereby generate confusion and disorder among our adversaries. Why? Because our adversaries will be unable to generate mental images that agree with the menacing as well as faster transient rhythm or patterns they are competing against. So it's all about the orientation stage again. If our actions are so fast and so well executed in terms of a successful coherent OODA loop, from the perspective of a slower opponent, they appear ambiguous and unpredictable, right? Automatically generating disorder, because the opponent, which is slower in case of a corporation or some other complex organization, is unable to generate a coherent mental image corresponding to reality. Right, so that opponent, that adversary, is automatically disrupted because of their inability to generate a mental image to successfully complete the orientation stage, thereby leading to successful action or decision and action. And it's key to understand here that the entire loop, right, the entire fast transient OODA loop, is a continuous process of cross-referencing, right, where you're continuously trying to touch reality or encounter reality, interface with external stimuli, which automatically would feed into your OODA loop. So this involves projection of some model onto reality, empathy with reality in order to register feedback, correlation of that feedback with the existing model, and rejection of the existing model if the feedback suggests that a new model should be deployed, right? So here is where the analytical and synthetical stages come in. And finally, this leads to that realization that the OODA loop is a constantly evolving model. It's probably incorrect to call it a model or a process as such, because it's a constantly evolving cyclical maneuver that our mind deploys continuously. And it's constantly evolving because the model of reality is evolving, and it is evolving because reality itself is changing continuously. Hence, it's open-ended, it's unpredictable, it leads invariably to unpredictable developments, and it is never homeostatic. It's never at equilibrium stage where we are in some sort of perfect agreement with reality. Right? This is a really hard concept to grasp here, that this process is never positive in the sense that it leads to an improvement. Right? It's a continuous struggle against entropy, and it's far from equilibrium, therefore. The way Boyd describes it, it's a far from equilibrium process of self-organization, emergence, and natural selection. So again, here we have it. We have observations feeding into orientations, where we deploy a model of reality, leading to decisions, where we deploy a hypothesis about our possible future actions and their outcomes, finally feeding to actions, which themselves automatically feed back into observations. That's it from me today about the OODA loop. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter @TedMeetYou. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.